I think this is a really amazing kind of topic today, hate speech, and obviously very appropriate to what we endured with Gaby Baby. But I wanted to talk to you today about the process of making that film. And I suppose, I made Gaby Baby with Charlotte Mars, who's the producer, and with our executive producer and writer, Billy Marshall Stone King, who unfortunately passed away recently. But when we started making this film, and I think, you know, really still today, debates over marriage equality were really rising in volume all around the country. And I can't tell you how many times I heard that argument that, you know, marriage is about having kids and kids need a mother and a father. And, you know, I kept on hearing politicians say things like, well, you know, what if we allow them to marry? Like, would they have kids and would that be okay? And, you know, even though gays can't marry, obviously they've been having children for generations already, and I know that because I'm one of them. And my mums have been together, actually last week they celebrated their 32nd anniversary, which is quite an achievement. I don't think I'm ever going to make it that far. And, you know, I think we are in such an incredible moment in history, you know, because of advancements in reproductive technology, because of the lifting of laws. You know, when I was a child, it was, you know, we didn't have sperm banks that were that same-sex couples were given access to. And obviously the slow but sure rising of public opinion has meant that we are literally in a gaby boom. Like, there are heaps of them out there. And I suppose I felt in the current debate there was a voice missing. And so we decided to make that film, which was from the perspective of kids. And, yeah, so I suppose we knew what we wanted to do and we knew why it mattered. But at that point, Charlotte and I, we were, you know, we had $0, we had no experience, we'd never made a feature film, and literally nobody in the industry was going to give that opportunity to two untested, especially young women. I think we were 22 at the time. And thankfully, in 2012, crowdfunding had only just arrived in Australia. And so I remember Charlotte and I, we sat down and we looked at each other and it sort of sounded illegal and like lots of hard work, but we thought we'd give it a go. And so we joined with this company called Fan Dependent, and we raised, I think it was $112,000 in a 5-week campaign, which at the time was the most that any crowdfunding campaign had made with a film which was fiction or non-fiction. So that was pretty exciting. And I think I just want to tell you this little story, which kind of, I think, characterises our whole experience of making Gaby Baby through to impact, which is that we knew we had to, like, attract some attention to this crowdfunding campaign. And we saw that Penny Wong and Barnaby Joyce were going to be on Q&A. And so we went on down and I put a question into the panel. And I don't know if everyone's been like an audience member in Q&A, but you have to, you're not allowed to like have big brands and they, you know, you're walking in and they go, oh, could you like do up your shirt? Or, you know, you have to like sort of look appropriate. And so we're going in and we're wearing these big duffel coats and they're like, yep, cool, like go in. And then my question got picked and I sort of gave it to Barnaby Joyce and I was asking him about what he felt. Thought it might feel like to be a child with two mums while the country is debating whether they're allowed to marry. And when I stood up, I ripped, you know, we both ripped our t-shirts off and we had our crowdfunding URL on the across the front of our t-shirts, which was like handwritten by a friend of ours when we were walking out the door to go. And Tony Jones kept on coming back to us maybe like 3 or 4 or 5 times. And I think we made like $25,000 on that first night. So I suppose like the lesson there is that it's good to break the rules as long as you're on the right side of history or something like that. So I can't stress how important those first supporters were. The film, I think in some ways is theirs as much as it is ours. And there were so many moments, because it took, I think, 5 years with the impact campaign included, which is sort of still rolling on. And we constantly would go back to those supporters for, you know, for advice, you know, when we wanted to throw in the towel. And in the credits of the film, we actually put every single one of the, I think, 1,700 supporters of that campaign, which, so the credit goes for a really long time. And I suppose, for the record, you know, that really was the campaign that got us over the line with Screen Australia, and with philanthropic support as well, sort of garnered a lot of attention. So we had the money to make the film, but we still had to decide, I suppose, who the film really was for and how we were going to tell this story. And we decided, you know, I think that Gaby Baby couldn't be an advertisement for gay families. We decided that it needed to be a warts and all, a kind of like a love letter to the haters, in a way. And I think how we came to that decision, I sort of have to step back a moment and say, you know, when I was a kid, it wasn't uncommon for people to make all sorts of judgments about me and my family. And usually I was told, you know, I was different with that unsubtle subtext that that difference was bad. You know, people in the playground would say things like, do you miss having a dad? Or, you know, are you going, you're going to be gay because your parents are? And when I was younger, in my defence, I would say, no, my family is normal. You know, it's just like yours. I'd talk about, you know, how perfect my mums were, because if I mentioned any sort of kink in the armour, I'd be worried that they would think that, you know, would blame my parents' sexuality on that. So us older queer spawn, now we laugh about it, and we like to refer this as poster child syndrome, which is sort of like that notion of always trying to put on a happy face for fear of playing into the rampant prejudices that assumed that our parents were somehow not good enough. And so I was thinking about all of this, and I think, you know, with this film, we started to realise that it really was not doing justice to my queer family to simply assert our normacy. You know, somewhere it was important to express the richness of differences and show kids that sometimes got let down and parents that yelled at each other. And I suppose, in a sense, the unique differences that offered. So, yeah, Gaby Baby is really not an advertisement for gay families in the end. It needed to be a film that didn't shy away from some of those things I would have said in my younger years. And I suppose sort of a slogan for the campaign and for the film has always been that no one should have to say that they are normal or the same in order to be seen as equal. I don't know how many people have actually seen the film, but I just thought I'd play the trailer of it before I started to talk about the impact campaign.
I don't know, like, anyone who has a family like mine.
Same-sex couples cannot simultaneously provide both mothering and fathering skills that a child desperately needs.
I really want to get into Newtown. It'd probably be the place where I'd most be accepted.
I am on the long road to puberty when you become a man.
I think it's okay to lie about having two dads.
My mom has told me about the priest at church telling us that mom is sin against God.
It's not normal. You're not normal. The kind of things which go around my head.
But I don't really know when you're manly.
Personally, I think that God made everyone to be who they are.
Can you go to wrestling?
Yeah, when it comes to Australia, please.
I wasn't that accepting at first.
I worry that you start thinking that that's the way that you be an interesting man.
You could say things like, I'm this tall and I weigh this much.
And I have two dads.
We really do disagree on something important to both of us.
Kids sometimes can come up with better ideas than adults.
Oh, you look so old.
What, you want me to look six again?
That'd be good.
The people who raise you and make you who you are today are your family.
Not all good things in life come easy.
Mm. the film off the ground, we made the film, and then we kind of began, I suppose the marriage equality debate is still going on, obviously, and we began to see that the film could be used by policymakers and educators, and we believed that in some ways it could be more than just a film. We also wanted to use it for good. And so we embarked, it's kind of, in some ways, it's quite a radical idea, I think, for feature filmmaking, even though it's still quite a new thing. You know, there's typically a way things that are done, which is when you release a film, maybe it gets into the cinema for documentary, it usually doesn't, then it goes on sale on DVD somewhere on some website, and then it has a minor TV run, usually ends up on some dusty shelf. So with these aspirations, we were selected for this event called The Good Pitch. And I don't know if anyone has heard of this, but is an event that happens all over the world, started in New York, and it's all about marrying documentary filmmaking to social impact campaigns. It's really amazing, actually. And so we pitched in the Opera House to a select audience across our issue, across corporate Australia, philanthropy, community groups, policymakers, and we developed a coalition of partners to use this film when it was released. And this really gave us the independence, the idea that, and the courage, I suppose, to release the film independently in Australia. So at this point, we'd screened in some really fantastic international festivals. This is another moment, I suppose, where everyone's like, yeah, that is such a stupid idea. So we decided to release the film. We decided it was a film about kids, so we wanted to release it to Australia's youth first. And so we literally were like handwriting on DVDs and sending the film to schools to be played in school halls the week it went, before it went into cinemas, for Wear It Purple Day, which is a student-led initiative. Yeah. Which is a student-led initiative all about celebrating and reflecting LGBT youth in schools. Yeah, we literally were giving out our film for free with like a return envelope to send back after your screening before it went into cinemas, and all the distributors were like, you're crazy. And it was that week, that a couple of days before Wear It Purple Day, that we saw the front cover of the Daily Telegraph newspaper, which was a picture of Gus in the trailer applying lipstick that said gay class uproar. And commentators went like crazy that we would be releasing a film that would be brainwashing Australia's youth into thinking that same-sex families were normal. Back to that normal thing. And what was really terrifying was that we had top government ministers and the Premier, Mike Baird, and the Education Minister who responded by banning the film from being screened in schools across the state. And, you know, media, yeah, was just sort of in overdrive. I think it was like hot topic on Twitter. It was number one trending Twitter for like 3 days, which is usually a good litmus test. And what was interesting is that we had like a state-by-state battle where this Victorian state premier welcomed the film in his state schools. There was like a rally. You know, it was just crazy, really full on. And I think one of the scariest things was that, you know, we had a 10-year-old child who was not warned that morning before they walked into the school gates that there was some serious, you know, hate speech on the front cover of our biggest newspaper. So it was quite scary, really. The kids really, like, walked us through that process. I think it was Gus, I called him up and I was like, are you okay? And have you seen the front cover? And he, like, looked at the cover and he was like, sweet, I'm on the front cover. Oh, God. So, ironically, you know, the film was made to replace these usual polemics and negative rhetoric, but with personal stories. And I think what we were so shocked about was that most of the people commentating on this film had not even seen it. So it was literally the idea of same-sex families that could cause such a vicious debate amongst people, yeah, who had not seen it. I think one of, just as a little tiny moment that I remember is that it was amazing to walk down, say, Newtown and all sorts, you know, suburbs in inner city Sydney to see cafes and fire brigades having signs outside of their shops saying things like, calm down and watch Gabby Baby, and then opened in cinemas so you could. I suppose what we learnt that week is that sometimes change looks ugly. And while it was really, really tricky, I think that we can say that, you know, you have to have been living under a rock to not know that kids and same-sex families exist and have done for generations. And at last, there was a dialogue about gabies that they were writing for themselves, which was pretty amazing to watch. The other big area, I suppose, that we felt really passionate about was education. And I'll just tell you a quick story which kind of really inspired, I think, our whole movement. We did create one of the first education resource in Australia to comprehensively reflect same-sex family structures and explore family diversity, which was pretty amazing, using that film as a multimodal core piece of curriculum. But Rory, who's Gus's little sister in the film, she just started in kindergarten. And in the class, I don't know if you guys have done this, but they were hatching little chickens and eggs in class, and the teacher's like, oh, well, you know, you need a rooster and a hen to make an egg. And Rory, one of the little boys in Rory's class, put up his hand and was like, well, miss, you're wrong, because Rory's got two mums and she's born. And the teacher just froze and didn't know what to say, and so ignored the question. And the following weeks, Rory was the one that had to, you know, answer all these questions about, you know, her biology and where she came from and blah, 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 from all of, you know, 26 people in her class and then the rest of the school. And as a result, she just didn't go to school because it was too intense. And because we don't have any structure, or we're not, you know, most teachers are not homophobic, but by ignoring the questions, they make the child do the work. And we felt that that was not fair. And so, yeah, I suppose the education resource that we've made is, it's both student-facing and teacher-facing. It's about supporting teachers to understand about what modern family might look like and LGBT family structures. So, yeah, that's pretty exciting. And it's also free from our website if you want to download it and have a look, which was pretty amazing. Through that good pitch, we were sort of financially supported that we were able to make it accessible to teachers in that way. Yeah, there was lots of other wins, and I don't want to go on for too long, but we were screening in Parliament Houses across the country, and we had adoption equality raised in lots of states after the film was made, which was pretty fantastic. I think, you know, we've learned a lot. And Charlotte and I, we were 22 when we started making that film and really were just running with it. But it wasn't until we came to making our own film that we really realised that most of the films in the world are made by old white men, and they're funded by old white men, and they're distributed by old white men. And I think that's pretty shocking, considering that films form such a significant part of the way that we construct the world. And I think when all the stories that we're being fed come from this tiny select group of people, you know, we have to ask, you know, are these the narratives that are really reflecting our lives? And I think in all of this, you know, the driving question for me as a creator, and hopefully of lots of people in this new generation, is that, you know, how can we as young filmmakers challenge the status quo, and how can we tell stories that accurately reflect our lives, the world around us, and what matters? So that's it. Thanks.